Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2021 Concern Debates Cup Final between Bailieborough Community School from County Cavan and Presentation De La Salle Bagenalstown from County Carlow. My name is Claire Williams and I am honoured to have been asked by Concern to act as chairperson for today's debate. Before we introduce today's finalists, we have a short video from Dominic McSorley, the Chief Executive of Concern, to say a few words of welcome.
Hi everyone, I'm really glad to have the opportunity to say a few words for this, the 38th year of the debates. And despite COVID and all these challenges, we're delighted to see that over 100 schools enrolled from all across Ireland. Well done everybody for keeping the debates going online. You're really reflecting Concern's own ethos of staying and delivering even in the toughest circumstances. And why are these debates more important than ever? Well, we only have 10 years before we reach 2030, when every nation had promised to deliver a better, safer world where no one has to live in poverty and hunger. But we're losing ground. The combination of climate, conflict, and now the COVID pandemic has set back progress on zero poverty and hunger by at least 25 years. Now, this is not an excuse for giving up. In fact, it's a reason for doing more. And we need to get behind the UN Secretary General's call for a decade of action, mobilizing more governments, civil society, and businesses to make the goals their own. We need a global effort to end poverty and hunger, rescue the planet, and build a peaceful world. And we all have a role to play, especially your generation. And that's why I've always been inspired to attend the debate's finals, whether the cup or our newly created shield, to hear for myself the passion, intelligence, ability, and confidence that young people are bringing to create this better world. The motion for today's cup final is savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. It's a timely and hugely important debate, and I'm really looking forward to hearing how people argue this. Let me congratulate both teams, Bailieborough Community School of County Cavan and Presentation De La Salle Bagenalstown, County Carlow, for reaching the final, and to wish you both the very best of luck. And of course, I want to thank the teachers for their incredible effort, support and guidance. Without you, the debate simply could not take place. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Dominic. Although things look a little bit different this time around, back in 2016, I was in your shoes. I was a member of St. Joseph's College debate team, and we were lucky enough to reach the finals. Although we didn't come in first, we were lucky enough to win an incredible trip to Brussels and The Hague, where we got to visit institutions such as the International Criminal Court, the European Parliament, and the Peace Palace. This trip and my involvement with debating throughout secondary school allowed me to foster my interest in global affairs and human rights. I went on to study law in Trinity College at third level, which I finished last year, focusing on subjects like international human rights law and refugee law. I'm currently studying a master's in international relations at Leiden University, so as soon as it's safe to do so, I'll be moving to The Hague, the home of international law, to finish my master's. That's how much of an impact the trip had. But the Concern debates really aren't about winning or losing. The value is in the experience, and all teams here today have already achieved so much, and hopefully will carry the experiences with them for the rest of their lives. This year, despite all the challenges of the COVID pandemic, which meant the Concern debates moving to an online format, over 100 schools registered for the 2020-2021 Concern All-Ireland debates. So I'd like to start by congratulating both teams for reaching the final. It's an amazing achievement, and I hope you are all really proud of yourselves, because I know your parents, teachers, schools, and counties certainly are. It's now my pleasure to introduce both teams and their mentors. Proposing the motion, we have Bailieborough Community School. The team members are team captain Shane Hogan, David Farrelly, Claire Finnegan-Murphy, and Luke Delaney. The team mentor is Caroline Quinn. Opposing the motion, we have Presentation De La Salle Bagenalstown. The team members are Stephanie Doyle, team captain, Stanislav Ustinov, Katie Doyle, and Dylan O'Neill. The team mentor is Leon Power. Let me wish both teams the very best of luck in the debate. This is the 38th year of the Concern debates, and over that time, we have challenged students to engage in a huge variety of global development issues. To date, more than 50,000 young people have taken up that challenge. not only debating issues related to human rights, poverty, and climate change, but also acquiring skills in critical thinking, analysis, and persuasion. CONCERN recognizes the crucial role that teachers and parents have played in supporting their respective teams, and we thank them sincerely for their efforts. It is CONCERN's hope that those who take part in or attend the debates will become lifelong advocates on behalf of the world left behind, and in so doing, bring about a better world for all. If you'd like to interact online during the debates, today's social media handles are hashtag #ConcernDebatesCupFinal, #ConcernDebatesCup, and #ConcernDebateIt. Feel free to use these hashtags for today's debate to promote it on social media, but please remember to keep your phones on silent at all times during the debate. We would ask those not speaking to keep your microphones muted while the debate's happening. Also, please leave clapping until the end of the debate so as not to distract any of the speakers. You can, of course, use the clapping reaction button on Zoom. Today's debate will run as follows. First, there'll be the formal debate, then a 20-minute team break whilst adjudicators deliberate, while the adjudicator deliberations take place. Then there'll be a return for the video presentations while the adjudicator deliberations continue. And then the chief adjudicator will deliver the feedback to both teams and the result will be announced. While the adjudicators are deliberating, everyone will have an opportunity to take a short break before returning to hear the decision. So the motion for today before the House is savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. No debate could happen without adjudicators, and today is no exception. We are delighted to welcome our adjudication panel. Our chief adjudicator is Linda Golden. Linda is an English teacher with a keen interest in development issues and debating. She's been involved with university debates and the CONCERN debating competition, both as a mentor and adjudicator throughout her long teaching career. She believes the debates play a significant role in educating students about the wider world and in promoting active citizenship. Linda received a Volunteers Award from CONCERN in 2020 and traveled overseas with CONCERN to Kenya in 2018. Linda will be ably assisted by Kathy Crowley, who lives in Kilkenny and worked for a number of years as European sales manager for a manufacturing company in Waterford. Kathy joined CONCERN Home Volunteers in 1984 and has been involved with CONCERN debates since they started in that same year. Kathy is always impressed by students who have the courage and commitment to take on the challenge of the CONCERN debates and invariably give us so much food for thought. Vincent Coyne has been involved with the CONCERN debates for about 20 years. A retired civil servant, he now works in a voluntary capacity with the Irish Cancer Society. His thematic interests include the plight of refugees, equality, particularly gender equality, and climate change. Aoife Flood is a former CONCERN debater who captained the St. Joseph's College Lucan team from 2016 to 2018. She is now an adjudicator for both the primary and secondary schools programmes and has chaired the All-Ireland semi-final debates, as well as contributing to the CONCERN Debate podcast. Aoife is currently a third-year history and French student in Trinity College Dublin and is the secretary of Trinity's Archaeological Society. Adele Burton is a pharmacist and PhD researcher at University College Cork. Adele has been involved in debating for many years and has won both local and regional competitions. She founded her own Munster-wide debating and oratory competition, which is the first of its kind, and introduced debating to many societies in University College Cork. Adele has adjudicated an array of local, regional, national, and international debating competitions, and is involved in coaching in Ireland and abroad. The timekeepers for today are Niamh Riley and Adam Zielinski. And for those of you who may be attending a CONCERN debate for the first time, let me briefly run through the rules. Each participant speaks for 4 minutes and 30 seconds. The bell is sounded at 3 minutes and again at 4 minutes, 15 seconds, at which time the speaker has 15 seconds to finish up. Anyone speaking for longer than 4.5 minutes will incur a time penalty. I will now ask the timekeeper in each school to sound the bell so that you know what to listen out for. Please remember, heckling and sarcastic remarks are out of place and will be penalised by the adjudicators. There will be a brief pause between each speaker to give the adjudicators time to award marks. I would ask the chief adjudicator to indicate when they are ready to proceed and I will introduce the next speaker. So, with all that behind us, I now have the pleasure of introducing the captain of the proposition, Shane Hogan, from Bailieborough Community School, who says that his favourite quote from the debates this year was during the Billionaires Should Not Exist debate, when his teammate Claire Finnegan Murphy said, "You don't make $1 billion, you take $1 billion," as it perfectly demonstrated his team's arguments and was extremely thought-provoking. So to propose the motion, savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive, I give you Shane Hogan.
The scathing impact of the COVID-19 pandemic has been felt by everyone across the global community. But these savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. In November last, UK Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab announced the British government's decision to change its aid commitment from 0.7 to 0.5%. My name is Shane, and I'm here today with my teammates, David, Luke, and Claire, to vehemently condemn these savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government and to highlight the devastating impact that these cuts will have on the poorest, most vulnerable communities in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, opposition, chairperson, and adjudicators, these cuts have been described by CEO of Save the Children, Kevin Watkins, as unprincipled, unjustified, and profoundly harmful, both to Britain's reputation and, more importantly, to millions of people around the world. I want to define the motion so that everyone here has an appreciation of the gravitas of this motion. The proposition is using Cambridge Dictionary to find key terms that underpin this motion and condemn the British government's callous attacks on the poorest of the poor. The word savage may be defined as extremely violent, wild, or frightening. Unjustifiable, unacceptable and wrong because there was no good or fair reason for it. Counterproductive, having an effect that is the opposite of the one intended or wanted. We on the proposition want to add to the motion the concept of false economy, as this is fundamental to our argument in condemnation of these savage cuts. False economy, an apparent financial saving that actually costs more in the long run. Make no mistake, the poorest, the most vulnerable, the most unfairly treated communities in the world will suffer if this morally and legally unjustifiable proposal is not defeated and reversed with immediate effect. On the concern.org.uk news website, it is estimated that this diabolical proposal will result in the deaths of 100,000 people. Condemning these scathing cuts, numerous charities have told the Guardian newspaper on the 26th of 11th, 2020, that nearly 3 million women and children will go without life-saving nutrition and that 5.6 million children will be left unvaccinated. Now, the opposition will put forward a narrative of how the British government has been forced to make these cuts in light of the COVID-19 pandemic, whilst lauding the fact that this decision will still leave the British government as one of the biggest development superpowers. However, my teammate David will debunk this morally reprehensible argument by describing the devastating impact that this proposal will have on impoverished communities like the DRC. My teammate Claire will speak to you on how this contemptible false economy will result in political instability. And my teammate Luke will speak to you on how this short-sighted decision is actually counterproductive to British interests. I implore you all here not to succumb to the narrative of aid skepticism that the opposition will put forward. In an article in the concern.org.uk news, it succinctly states that, first and foremost, overseas aid works. It goes on to state that since 1990, the amount of people living in extreme poverty has more than halved. The proposition will leave you in no doubt that this proposal is a false economy and that the ramifications of this proposal will be far-reaching and devastating, resulting in death, hunger, and political instability. This proposal can only be viewed as a retrograde step in the fight against poverty and justice for all. I beg you to propose this motion.
Thank you, Shane. I would now like to introduce you to the captain of the opposition, Stephanie Doyle, from Presentation De La Salle in Bagenalstown. When asked about where she gets her inspiration from when preparing for a debate, Stephanie says, "I get my greatest debating inspiration when I'm relaxed. There's no point in tackling a motion when your mind is full of other thoughts. Instead, you have to stay cool, calm, and collected. I give myself the time to think about what the motion means to me and what story I want to tell. Like every good story, I want my speech to have a beginning, middle, and end that resonates with everyone listening. Something that moves people to react to the issue or debate at hand. So to oppose the motion, I give you Stephanie Doyle.
Isn't it easy to judge, but hard to acknowledge? Good morning, adjudicators, chairperson, timekeeper, members of the proposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Stephanie Doyle, and today I, along with my fellow teammates, are wholeheartedly opposing the motion. Savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. I would like to thank Shane for defining the motion. However, we, the opposition, believe that parts of their definition do not accurately reflect the motion before the House tonight. Shane, you said that savage is something that is extremely violent and frightening. However, according to the Merriam-Webster Dictionary, savage is something that is malicious, uncontrolled, and to attack brutally. Shane, you said unjustifiable is something that is unacceptable and wrong because there is no valid reason for it. However, your definition of unjustifiable is not reflective of the motion. Unjustifiable is something that is not right or sensible for any reason as stated by the Macmillan Dictionary. Unjustifiable is an ambiguous term. What is unfair and unjust to one person is completely acceptable and the right thing to do for another. Proposition, for something to be unjustifiable, there cannot even be one valid reason, any logic behind this motion. With all this in mind, the proposition are placed with a heavy responsibility. They must show that these cuts are a malicious and brutal attack by the British government, but even more so, they must prove that there's not even one valid reason behind these cuts, even if we agree or disagree. They must show that cutting aid will have no benefit to the UK against the bar that we set. And if they don't prove this, this motion must be defeated. This morning, my teammates and I have a story to tell for anyone who is bold enough to listen, anyone who is willing to come to the table with ears and minds open. And just like every old tale, our story has characters. Characters will tell the story of the untold truths when it comes to British aid. Our second speaker, Staz, is your analyst. He will uncover how for years foreign aid has been misdirected and how it feeds corruption. Our third speaker, Katie, is your British citizen. She will show how COVID-19 has only heightened social problems in Britain, such as unemployment and education. Our fourth speaker, Dylan, is your very own politician, shedding light on how UK trade triumphs their aid and how the UK government are bringing alternatives to the table. Today, I am your unforgiving journalist for reporting the facts as they are, and I'll be bringing coverage to you live about the thought process and the real story behind today's motion. From the onset, I need to make it absolutely clear that we understand and acknowledge how serious any cut is to overseas aid and that it must be taken with careful consideration. However, we too recognise that just as every story has two sides, so too does this motion. We cannot forget that the British government is a parliamentary democracy. While MPs must operate according to foreign interests and their own conscience, their first responsibility is to their British people, source UK Parliament. Since 2013, the United Kingdom has consistently met the UN target to spend 0.7% of their gross national income on foreign aid, sourced the Institute for Fiscal Studies. But interestingly, only five countries met their goal in 2019, one of which was the UK, as stated by the new humanitarian. Even Ireland, our own nation, did not meet her goal. Ladies and gentlemen, how can we preach from the pulpit about what is unjustifiable when we ourselves have never met the goals set by them? Today, the proposition will create the narrative that the British government are abandoning our world's most vulnerable at a time when they need it most. However, despite the cuts to overseas aid, the British government has put numerous alternatives into place to ensure that the world's most vulnerable are protected. In a Sky News interview, Rishi Sunak, Chancellor of the Exchequer, said that the British government had a very significant defence settlement recently and that this funding will help them do humanitarian work around the world, particularly peacekeeping. Proposition, what is unjustifiable and savage now? The British government are putting alternatives into place, alternatives that will save lives in the developing world. Ladies and gentlemen, as Plato once said, things are not always as they seem. First appearances deceive many. All is not what it seems here today. I urge you to take a moment longer, to take a moment to see, to take a moment to realise, and I promise you will not miss it. Two valid reasons, one bold choice. Choose to oppose this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. The second speaker for the proposition is David Farrelly, who says that one of the debates he most enjoyed this year was about vaccinations being made mandatory, particularly in light of the COVID crisis. So to continue proposing the motion, I give you David Farrelly.
Stephanie has said that the British government is looking after the people. Well, it must be one set of rules for the rich and one set for the poor. chief proponent of this new insular nativism rampant in the UK is Brexiteer Boris Johnson, who is able to offer millionaire Sir James Dyson tax breaks for providing the NHS with ventilators during the COVID-19 pandemic, whilst at the same time pleading the poverty card for justifying these savage cuts to overseas aid budget. Boris Johnson offers absolutely no apology for fixing the problem of paying tax for Dyson, but remains indifferent to the plight of millions of the oppressed and destitute. Stephanie is trying to hoodwink you into believing that the British government is in dire straits. They were left with no choice. They were forced to make the tough but necessary decision. Our captain will bring to your attention the more insidious, long-term agenda of aid reform going on behind the closed doors of number 10 Downing Street. Let's be practical and take a look at what's being proposed. The British government want to reduce the amount of overseas aid from 0.7% to 0.5% of the GDP, which means for every £1 of tax paid, 5 pence goes to overseas aid instead of 7 pence. The UK is playing the poor us card, and the opposition would have you believe that these so-called temporary cuts are a result of the COVID-19 pandemic. However, what the opposition will not bring to your attention is the fact that overseas aid is tied to the UK's national income, its GDP, which has already been badly affected as a result of the pandemic. Even if the 0.7% had been maintained, due to the reduction of the UK economy, there would have already been a decline in the aid budget anyway, of around £5.2 billion from 2020 to 2025. If these proposed disastrous cuts are not revoked, we could see a cumulative loss in the aid budget of around £25 to £30 billion by 2020. Money that would have helped the poorest, most oppressed countries across the world. We cannot allow this to simply happen and let the British public be duped by the growing insularism within British politics. It is imperative that we are vocal in our condemnation of this proposal. The UK's national deficit stands at £400 billion. If this disastrous proposal is not revoked, it will only save £4 billion and will have no impact on national debt. CEO of ActionAid UK, Gurmish Menon, has stated that these cuts will be felt hugely by the world's poorest communities, but will make very little difference to the UK's public purse, as it is equal to 0.2% of the UK's total income. How can the opposition justify paying the bills of COVID off the backs of the poorest, most oppressed, most vulnerable communities? The opposition are failing to take in term the long-term ramifications that these proposed savage cuts will have. At least 100,000 people will die. A rise in extreme poverty. These savage cuts will inevitably exacerbate the refugee crisis, terrorism, and lead to inwards migration. These proposed cuts are ultimately a false economy. The World Bank has said that COVID means 150 million people are at risk of extreme poverty. And it is within this context that the British government makes these unfair, unscrupulous, unjustified cuts to much needed aid. We in the proposition believe that rich countries like Britain should make colonial reparations to former colonized countries that they ruthlessly exploited, like Gambia, Ghana, and Nigeria. These are poor developing countries. A former Belgian colony, the DRC, is one such example of a country experiencing a dire need of aid. For two decades, conflict has plagued the DRC. 21.3 million people are experiencing acute food shortages. That's 1 in 3 of the population. 7 million people are just one step away from catastrophe. This is the real cost of this unjustified and counterproductive motion proposed by the British government. I beg you to propose the motion.
Thank you, David. Our second speaker from the opposition is Stanislav Ustinov, who says that by taking part in the concern debates, he has learned that he was completely oblivious to many of the topics he was asked to debate, like wealth inequality, vaccine management, and how on the surface problems can look simple, but can be very complex and multi-layered deep down. So disagreement on solutions is natural, but infinitely interesting. To oppose the motion, I give you Stanislav Ustinov.
Isn't it easy to judge, but hard to acknowledge? Good morning, Chairperson, adjudicators, members of the proposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Stas, and I'm your careful analyst for today's motion. I want to make it very certain that for far too long, British government foreign aid has been misdirected and is not reaching its aims. Shane, you said that the reputation of the UK will be damaged. However, it will still leave the UK aid spending much higher than it was in 2010, despite big cuts in many other areas of public spending. And Britain will remain one of the world's biggest aid donors, source Institute of Fiscal Studies. Their reputation will not be damaged, Shane. As Stephanie has mentioned, we believe in the power of aid. We understand, when used correctly, that aid has the potential to create change, growth, and prosperity. We need to remove our rose-tinted glasses and see the bigger picture. British government foreign aid is not used correctly and therefore warrants a justified cut. David, you said that the British government is able to give millionaires our tax breaks. However, Rishi Sunak combined stimuluses this year with plans of spending to cut billions of pounds of tax increases on companies and individuals in the biggest revenue-raising budget since 1993, source Bloomberg. We are all familiar with the rigmarole of Brexit, Boris, and the British government. It may seem like you have better cabinets at this stage. However, the proposal to make cuts is justified and productive in helping Britain reassess and regrow. In a perfect world, foreign aid would be the cure to all the inequalities facing the developing world. But all that glitters is not gold. In 2015, Britain was bound by law to donate aid overseas. However, this law must have the purpose of reducing poverty, according to the Library of Congress. Fortunately, British foreign aid is not achieving this goal. The Guardian confirms that too much of Britain's aid budget is being spent poorly on projects that fail the test of reducing poverty in developing worlds. David, according to BBC News, in 2015, £12.5 billion in aid was ineffective in reducing poverty and left people worse off by maintaining bad governance. The One Campaign is a global movement advocating to end extreme poverty. In 2018, the One Campaign's Real Aid Index report stated that £1.5 billion of British government aid was being spent with no direction to where or how it was going. Unbelievably, not one of the five poorest countries in the world is among the top 10 recipients of British aid. Herman Hesse, a local businessman from Ghana, expressed that foreign aid is a serious obstacle to his business enterprise. He stressed that only Africans develop Africa. We have to either sink or swim on our own, and Africa can swim. Dambisa Mayo, a Zambian economist and author, also agrees. She also stated that more than $1 trillion in development aid given to Africa in the past 50 years has failed to deliver economic growth and poverty reduction, and has actually made the continent worse off. These personal accounts give us pause to ponder for a moment longer. Unfortunately, the British government foreign aid also feeds into the pre-existing cancers plaguing these developing nations. The main culprit, corruption. According to the British Institute of Economic Affairs, aid is misdirected, wasted, or falls in the hands of corrupt governments. British government foreign aid to the world's most corrupt countries has risen by more than 33% in 5 years, reaching a massive $1.5 billion in 2018, and this figure is rising, source Wall Street Journal. For example, in 2017, the British government was forced to suspend a $12 million aid scheme to Syria after reports of aid being diverted to extremist terrorist groups. For decades now, Britain has been blindly throwing money at developing nations, buying them shoes that don't fit, stairs with no steps, a voice with no volume. Instead of live aid, we're now putting a band-aid on the developing world. Aid is like putting a plaster on a leaking roof, always a short-term fix and never a long-term solution. Proposition, we must allow the British government to cut the umbilical cord of corruption and misdirection, allow them to reassess, reevaluate, and regrow. With this in mind, we can only come to one bold conclusion. The proposed cuts to British overseas aid is justified and is productive. Four valid reasons. One bold. Thank you.
Thank you, Stanislav. So our third speaker for the proposition is Claire Finnegan Murphy. Now, earlier we heard how Shane's favourite quote from this year's debates was one from Claire. Well, it so happens that Claire's favourite quote was one from Shane when he said in the George Floyd debate, he survived the coronavirus infection only to die at the hands of another pandemic, the pandemic of racism. She says she likes this quote as it illustrates how there are simply more than one pandemics happening in the world at the moment. To propose the motion, I give you Claire Finnegan Murphy.
He who controls the media controls the minds of the public. Wise words from Noam Chomsky, which highlights the problem of disinformation that serves as a political agenda. Contrary to the opposition, we are acknowledging the half-truths and misdirection the opposition are peddling, not judging. According to a YouGov poll, 66% of Britain's support cutting the foreign aid budget, only 18% felt that this was the wrong decision. Make no mistake, that this is a political move to garner votes. But are the British public really aware of the social, economic, moral, and global ramifications of such a myopic decision in the guise of the national interest? Savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. Ladies and gentlemen, don't give in to the scaremongering aid scepticism put forward by the opposition's disingenuous narrative. The rise of insularism in British politics resulted in Brexit and the growing xenophobia and racism in the UK. The inward focus on self-preservation is seriously counterproductive to Britain's interests. The COVID-19 pandemic has had devastating impacts to the global economy. The opposition are telling you that the UK is simply cutting its cloth to meet its purse, so to speak. Are the opposition seriously expecting us to believe that it is justifiable to the British government to renege on its commitment 0.7% overseas aid target then that it was established by the UN in the Pearson Commission and then enshrined in law in 2015 by David Cameron's government? Surely there are other ways of saving money from the public purse, or is the current British government trying to curry favor the populace? With all due respect to the opposition, I think they are failing to take into consideration the long-term ramifications of this retrograde step. These proposed cuts to overseas aid are ultimately a false economy. People generally don't like paying taxes, but the British public need to appreciate the real cost and gravitas of these proposed cuts. Speaking on Sky News on the 6th of March, Chair of the House of Commons, Tobias Elwood, stated that it should be explained to the British people that extremism, terrorism, refugee crises, migration will all be affected once we take this retrograde step. Author of the CARE report, Sarah Furman, has asked the same question I would like to direct to the opposition. Do we want to look back on 2020 as the time that we let the pandemic and its effects get to the point where people are at huge risk of famine? Or do we look back and say we pull together to literally save people's lives? Ladies and gentlemen, there is a perfect storm of catastrophe brewing. COVID-19, the climate change crisis, conflict and economic decline that the UN have described as an acute and grave crisis in Afghanistan, Burkina Faso, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Nigeria, South Sudan, Yemen, where millions are experiencing emergency level food shortages, sourced The Guardian, 18th of November, 2020. This decision to impose cuts on overseas aid must be rescinded. These cuts will lead to political instability, which means more wars, more death, more hunger, more injury, more hurt, more hopeless, more devastation. James Wani, Christian Aid's director in South Sudan, said, cuts on a scale that have been reported couldn't have come at a worse time for a country in crisis. Without funding for peace building, the talks risk failure. And without peace, development and humanitarian work can't succeed. People in South Sudan cannot afford for that to happen. Source www.opendemocracy.net. Join me and my teammates in our vehement condemnation of these proposed cuts. Let your voice join with ours in our demand that these proposed cuts be rescinded. I beg you to propose the motion.
Thank you, Claire. Our third speaker for the opposition is Katie Doyle. One of the things Katie learned this year was that she just loved taking part in the concern debates. She says, I truly did not think that I would get so much enjoyment and inspiration from them. I look forward to every meeting with the team and also love researching the different topics and motions. I feel very lucky to be able to take part in the competition and I'm so grateful for the opportunity to do so. So to oppose the motion, I give you Katie Doyle.
Isn't it easy to judge, but hard to acknowledge? Good morning, adjudicators, chairperson, timekeeper, members of the proposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Katie Doyle, and today I am your British citizen. I represent the voice of the people who are just as important in today's debate. I will focus on the British government and discuss the poverty within Britain in girls' education and the impact that COVID-19 has had on the country. But before I begin, I must stress that we understand that overseas aid does improve and save many lives. However, we also acknowledge that many people in Britain are suffering too. How can you be expected to look after others while you are also struggling to look after yourself? Much to the horror from Mrs. Doyle and Father Ted. No matter how much she says, go on, you cannot pour tea from an empty cup. As mentioned by Stas, the One campaign set up by our very own rockstar Bono aims to end extreme poverty. However, it seems that much of British foreign aid is being spent where the streets have no name. Too much foreign aid is not reaching its target, and Britain should focus on alleviating their own poverty. Period poverty, the lack of access to sanitary products due to financial constraints, has had a negative impact on the education of many girls throughout the UK. A survey conducted by Plan International UK reports that 1 in 10 girls have been unable to afford sanitary products, and it is estimated that currently over 137,000 girls across the UK have missed at least a day of school due to period poverty, sourced the Royal College of Nursing. In redirecting some of their funds in the British government's budget, they can begin to tackle issues like period poverty. Shane, you made the claim that the cut will cause the poorest to suffer. However, the poorest countries lose $116,000 every second due to unfair trade barriers and fraud. This is 24 times what they receive in aid, Shane. Source World Counts. Ladies and gentlemen, we unfortunately cannot predict the future. If we could, then we'd have the winning lotto numbers every night, but we can't. And despite pressure from the media, neither can the British government. They had no idea of the seismic impact that COVID-19 would have on their economy. They have been forced to make tough but necessary decisions, including the proposal of reducing the overall amount they spend on overseas aid temporarily to cover coronavirus-related expenditure, source Sky News. We understand that COVID-19 is a global issue. However, it has had a significant negative impact on some of the poorest in Britain. Around 7.6 million jobs are at risk due to COVID-related lockdowns, and people and places with the lowest incomes are most vulnerable to job loss, source McKinsey and Company. The homelessness rate in the UK has also risen significantly due to the coronavirus. According to The Guardian, more than 70,000 households have been made homeless since the start of the pandemic, with tens of thousands more predicted. Shane, this is not hyperbole, but fact. How can you justify neglecting these issues that are rampant in the UK? Ladies and gentlemen, as vital as facts and figures are in a debate, we believe that a personal account is vital too. Jodie, mother of four, had her life turned upside down when her partner lost his job in March of 2020 due to the COVID-19 pandemic in the UK. This reduced their income to zero, forcing them to become homeless, source Salvation Army. Claire, this is a real life example of why the British government needs to spend money at home. How can you justify neglecting these issues that are rampant in the UK? David, you made the claim that the British government only care about helping the rich. However, in January 2021, Britain had donated $5.4 billion to a variety of charities at home and abroad, source The Telegraph. David, this is more than the proposed cut from the British government's budget. They still do care. Claire, you implied that this cut is unlawful. However, according to a Sky News interview, Rishi Sunak said that the existing law that they have has set up provisions in it which allow the temporary difference from the aid target. They are abiding by their laws, Claire. Ladies and gentlemen, it is not selfish, unreasonable, or unjustifiable for the British government to have the best interests of their people at heart. When we take a deeper look into the poverty engulfing Britain, we can only come to one conclusion. To help those at home, making some cuts to overseas aid is justifiable and productive. Britain must have a say in how their budget is spent, and if it means making changes to help those on home soil, that is justifiable. Six valid reasons, one bold choice. Choose to oppose the motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Katie. The fourth speaker for the proposition is Luke Delaney. Luke says that the most important debate in the world right now is about wealth and inequality, and that a lot of work needs to be done to prevent the exploitation of the poor by the wealthy and put an end to the vicious cycle of poverty. So I now like to call on Luke Delaney, please.
The British have adopted an almost cyclops approach to running the country. They have adopted an inward, self-interested approach that will invariably damage the country's reputation. These proposed cuts will see Britain's power diminished in terms of promoting free trade and democratic processes. This will allow countries such as Russia and China to have greater influence in these fragile communities. With all due respect to the opposition, how can you, in good conscience, allow this to happen? Both of these superpowers have a history of human rights violation and exploitation. The opposition's arguments seek to undermine the phenomenal work done all over the world by charities by mentioning a few rare cases taken out of context. The UK has strict reporting arrangements in place to ensure the best value for money and taxpayers, sourceconcern.org.uk. But you're always going to have detractors who take something out of context. For example, at the minute, chief supporter of these claims is Jeremy Hutton from the Taxpayers Alliance, whose agenda is solely to serve profit-hungry, profit-driven corporations, disparagingly describing foreign aid as shoveling money out the door, source www.marketplace.org. With all due respect, Stanislav is peddling a narrative that promotes aid skepticism. They are trying to undermine the incredibly good work done by charities by making their efforts sound frivolous and superfluous. Jonathan Isby of the Taxpayers Alliance ridiculed the Girl Effect project, referring it to wasting £16 million on the Ethiopian Spice Girls. Well, this doesn't sound like a worthy aid project, does it? You might be forgiven for thinking so, but like so many of the opposition's aid skepticism stories, we are not given the full context. We in the proposition think that empowering women by challenging an oppressive status quo is not a frivolous and superfluous aim. A spokesperson for the Girl Effect Project stated 84% of girls listening to Yenga, Girl Hub's Ethiopian radio drama and talk show, said that it has helped them become more confident, while 76% said that it has inspired them to continue their education, source blackenterprise.com. But due to the aid skepticism and growing nativism in the UK and British media, this project lost their funding in 2017. Challenging an oppressive status quo is deemed not a worthy endeavor by the opposition and British government. My teammate Claire has already alluded to the power and irresponsibility of the media when it comes to propagating aid skepticism. After all, it's easy to judge, but hard to acknowledge, right? Even more disturbing is how this move is the first step by the British government in reneging on its commitments as a development superpower. In the midst of the backlash that this motion has provoked, Dominic Raab has promised that the UK government will focus on poverty reduction for the bottom billion. So this means that middle-income countries like India, where thousands are experiencing food shortages, will lose out. Andrew Shepherd of the Overseas Development Institute's Chronic Poverty Advisory Network has warned that this bottom billion approach means that less tangible but more useful programs fall by the wayside. He also highlighted that debt relief is now being considered as part of overseas development aid, putting a further squeeze on other aid, sourced The Guardian 26 November 2020. Stephanie would lead you to believe that these cuts are necessary as a result of the pandemic, but this is wrong. Professor Mithali Srinivas from Ohio State University said in a Twitter post that 82% of global vaccine doses have been in wealthy countries, only 0.2% in the poorest. Vaccine selfies on one side of the world, cremation pyres on the other. What sort of system can justify this type of inequality and suffering? How can the opposition and Britain justify giving tax breaks to major companies like Dyson, as my teammate has already stated, meanwhile cutting funds that are desperately needed in communities that are suffering the absolute worst effects of COVID-19? This is the first callous step by Brexiteer Johnson's government to reform overseas aid, which she's shifting emphasis from poverty focus to trade focus. So, ladies and gentlemen, what becomes of the countries who are in dire need of aid but can't offer Britain a desirable return on investment? This shifting emphasis on foreign aid to be more trade-focused rather than poverty-focused is surely not a path that both opposition and Britain want to go down. Nepal is an example of a country wherein there are 33 active projects funded by the UK, but only one of them has the Department of Trade funding behind it, so a country like this has little to no hope of receiving aid if new aid reforms come into effect. This is a retrograde step. This is a shambolic decision that will scupper the poorest of the poor. These proposed cuts are a false economy. Join key figures like Gordon Brown, David Cameron, Danny Sriskanderja of Oxfam, Baroness Sugg, former UK Foreign Office Minister, and staff and student body of Bailieborough Community School in morally condemning these proposed cuts that will result in death and devastation for the world's poorest communities. I beg you to propose this motion.
Thank you, Luke. The fourth speaker for the opposition is Dylan O'Neill, who tells us that while his opinions haven't changed during the course of the debates, he has gained an overall understanding of a subject rather than a simple one-sided biased interpretation. He says the closest he got to changing his opinion during the billionaire debate. But, he says, I still believe in the right to accrue wealth, but my opinions have become far more polished than before. So I'd now like to call on Dylan O'Neill.
Isn't it easy to judge, but hard to acknowledge? Ladies and gentlemen, adjudicator, chairperson, and members of the proposition. My name is Dylan O'Neill, and today I will delve into the murky abyss that is modern politics, as I represent your local, lovable, and ever-faithful politician. We are all incredibly stubborn and close-minded by nature. We choose to support detrimental institutions over reinventing or re-establishing new foundations. We value safety, security, and structure over innovation, renovation, and revolution. But let them be complacent, and to quote Marie Antoinette, a queen ahead of her time, let them eat cake, and let them be vaccinated. Shane, you said that Britain aren't committed to vaccinating those in the developing world. However, according to the BBC, Britain have fully committed to donating all surplus vaccines after they have vaccinated their own people. How can we find fault in such generous charity? To grow, we must change, and to change, we must be open to new ideas. The current foreign aid system is flawed. It's failing to accurately target the problems it was designed to eliminate, and it serves a little more than a gesture of goodwill between nations. As Stas has mentioned, Britain's main driving force for aid is to reduce poverty. Evidence proves that this is simply not working. Afghanistan have gone from 12 million people living in extreme poverty to 15. Yemen have gone from 14 to 19. And Nigeria have gone from a whopping 70 million people living in extreme poverty to an astounding 89 million people, source world poverty. In the wise words of Albert Einstein, insanity is defined as doing the same thing over and over and over again and expecting a different result. Ladies and gentlemen, we do not need to be theoretical physicists to understand that foreign aid is fundamentally failing. To change the effect, we must first change the cause. The solution, the big elephant in the room, trade. Britain are now focusing on solutions and alternatives, as my teammate Stephanie has mentioned. David, you said that Britain were exploiting Ghana. However, in 2020, trade agreements were discussed at the UK-Africa Investment Summit. Source, Sky News. According to Emma Wade-Smith, trade deals between the UK and Africa are a no-brainer, as they have and continue to pull more people out of poverty than any other economic activity. Barack Obama chorused the same message in a short but impactful manner. Africa needs trade, not aid. Trade increases employment. It brings technological advancement, education, and supports stable and strong relationships between nations. Trade is the engine for poverty reduction. A perfect example of how trade triumphs over poverty is our sleeping giant, China, a country that owes their economic development to trade. It's a running joke that everything we own and see nowadays is made in China. But realistically, it's actually not too far from the truth. According to the UN Statistics Division, China accounted for 28% of the global manufacturing output in 2018, making it by far the world's leading manufacturer. Economic development breeds other forms of development. After all, a rising tide lifts all boats. For example, the gross enrollment rate of higher education in China was just 3.4% in 1990. This number then increased to 45.7% by 2017. Source, Chinese International Trade. To solve the issues plaguing developing nations, we must support them in their independence. Claire, you said the poverty increased in Yemen and Afghanistan, but according to the UN, the Houthi regime is misdirecting British aid worth 130 million, meant to reach 3.2 million people in Yemen. Their aid is not working, Claire. Claire, you said that this cut will heighten poverty and conflict. However, as stated by the ITAD Foreign Secretary, Dominic Raab, the UK will double down on the effectiveness of their aid. Claire, this is not a cut, but instead a relocation. David, you said that the cut is not going to be a long-term solution for the future. However, Linda Chalker, former Minister of State for Overseas Development and Africa, said a smaller but better focused and managed aid budget could achieve more than the current one. David, this is exactly Britain's intention. They want to reassess the budget and see how aid can better contribute to development. As the British government provide alternatives to these cuts, we can only come to one conclusion. The ends justify the means. It is now time for the elephant in the room to lead out the big parade from aid to trade in the developing world. Ladies and gentlemen, 8 valid reasons. 1 bold choice. Choose to oppose this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Dylan. Ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to call back the captain of the opposition, Stephanie Doyle, to sum up on behalf of her team.
It is easy to judge, but it's even harder to acknowledge. Good morning, adjudicators, chairperson, timekeeper, members of the proposition, ladies and gentlemen. My name is still Stephanie, and today we are still firmly opposing the motion. Savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. Today, the proposition have failed to explain how these cuts are a malicious and uncontrolled attack by the British government. They've neglected to show how these cuts will not even benefit one single person on this planet. Today, the proposition have not proven how there's not even one valid reason behind these cuts, despite the countless examples that we have provided. Today, we are reiterating that this whole motion is based on the words unjustifiable and counterproductive. There must only be one logical reason, Shane. We do not have to agree with it or the reasoning, but instead must only try to understand, try to realise that there is a reason behind the so-called madness. Shane, you made the claim that overseas aid works. However, according to Angus Deaton, much of the $135 billion that the world's most developed countries spent on official aid in 2014 may not have ended up helping the poor, sourced the Washington Post. Luke, you said that the UK is abandoning vaccinations in the developed world. However, Britain is set to provide £500 million in aid funding for the COVAX Advanced Market Commitment, an international initiative to ensure that 92 of the world's poorest countries can access a vaccine for COVID-19, according to the Global Citizen. They are helping, Luke. Ultimately, Shane and his team have chosen to view this motion through rose-tinted glasses. They've chosen to portray the darkness, the pessimistic outlook of failure. We understand how serious any cut is to overseas aid, but we too recognise that just as every story has two sides, so too does this cut. Our second speaker, Staz, was your analyst, showing how governmental foreign aid has been failing the developing world for years, and how it's now time to change our ways if we really want to have an impact on saving lives. Our third speaker, Katie, was your British citizen. She uncovered that COVID-19 has increased homelessness and put the education of girls at risk. She told the unforgettable story of Jodie, mother of four who suffered immensely due to the pandemic. Our fourth speaker, Dylan, was your very own politician, shedding light on how the British government is not abandoning the world's most poor, but instead providing an alternative that will save lives in the developing world, ladies and gentlemen. Claire and David, you said that terrorism will increase due to these cuts. However, the United Kingdom has a commendable track record on UN peacekeeping. The UK has for some time been one of the largest financial contributors and used to be one of the largest contributors of troop, source the United Nations Association of the UK. Remember the military spending increase. This will help with that, David and Claire. Terrorism will not increase. Luke and Claire, you said that this cut will only heighten problems in the developing world. However, the Foreign Secretary, Dominic Raab, said he would prioritise poverty reduction for the bottom billion, as well as tackling climate change, biodiversity, championing girls' education, and UK leadership in the global COVID response, according to The Guardian. They will still be helping, Luke. Claire and David, you said that this cut needs to be revoked. However, on the 25th of November 2020, the Chancellor announced the public sector pay will be paused for 2021 to 2022, as stated by the Commons Library. They have no alternative choice, Claire and David. When British aid is failing the developing world, when the British people are suffering at home, and still the British government have put alternatives into place, we on this side of the house can only come to one conclusion. It is not unjustifiable or counterproductive to cut overseas aid. Ladies and gentlemen, Shane, Luke, Claire and David, today you have heard 8 valid reasons. We only needed one. We know how easy it is to point the finger of blame, how easy it is for us to forget how generous Britain have been and still will be despite the cut of 0.2%. As Margaret Thatcher once said, no one would remember the Good Samaritan if he only had good intentions. He had the money too. But will we only measure Britain's good intentions by the amount of aid they give? Today, I'm asking you to acknowledge, to choose to see an alternative, to recognise the difficult task the British government have. Ladies and gentlemen, be bold enough to see the reason. Be bold enough to acknowledge. Be bold enough to see it, even if you disagree. Be bold enough to have your beliefs challenged and be bold enough to oppose this motion. 8 valid reasons, 1 bold choice. Oppose this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. And finally, to conclude the debate, I ask Shane Hogan to sum up on behalf of his team.
Savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. My teammates, Claire and David, explained to you how these proposed cuts are morally unjustifiable. After all, poverty is all relative. Being classed as poor in the UK is not the same thing as being classed as poor in Yemen, the DRC, South Sudan, or Afghanistan. However, what's even more sinister about these proposed cuts is that they are not even legal, as Lord Macmillan and Lord Macdonald have challenged the legality of these cuts. As my teammate Claire made you aware of in her powerful speech, the aid target set by the UK was enshrined in law in 2015 by David Cameron's government. Dominic Raab does not even have the power to alter the target set. We on the proposition find it simply callous that just a few days before these proposed cuts to foreign aid were made, it was announced that there would be substantial increases in defense spending by 16.5 billion. Katie, the money saved at home is being spent on defense, not for the people. By reducing aid funding or by changing the priority, the UK will make it more difficult to achieve their sustainable development goals, especially SDG 1 on poverty reduction and SDG 5 on equality and women for girls. The COVID-19 pandemic has had a great impact on the lives of women. The proposition have failed to speak about how the plight of vulnerable women in these impoverished communities who have been impacted by the pandemic. As the men leave their communities in search of work and a better life, these impoverished women will be left behind or forced to live in displacement camps where they will become prey to violence, rape, early marriage, and sexual exploitation. However, my teammate David has debunked these morally reprehensible proposals by describing the devastating impact that these proposed cuts will have on impoverished communities like the Democratic Republic of the Congo. My teammate Claire spoke about how these cuts will exacerbate political instability in places like South Sudan. And my teammate Luke spoke about how the sinister shift in focus of foreign aid becoming more trade focused rather than poverty focused. Do come to the increasing aid skepticism that the opposition are peddling. Katie, are you aware that these savage cuts proposed by the British government were hinted at over 4 years ago in an article by the Guardian newspaper when the International Development Select Committee accused the Conservative International Development Secretary, Priti Patel, of having a malign right-wing agenda to scrap and undermine the UK support for the world's poorest people? This right-wing agenda is seen in the current International Development Secretary Anne-Marie Trevine, who tweeted in 2017 in relation to foreign aid as a waste of cash on vanity projects in far-flung lands keep me awake at night. Stanislav is peddling the narrative of aid skepticism. The proposition is agog at how the opposition are seeking to undermine the works of charities abroad. The Foreign Commonwealth Office received 600 million on the foreign aid budget in 2018. And according to One Real Aid Index for 2018, money was wasted. It wasn't the charities working at the coalface, trying to deal with the poverty, the famine, the war, and the despair that was wasting the money, but rather the FCO. If this decision to impose these savage cuts is not rescinded, then it is the poorest of the poor who will suffer, not those in their comfy chairs with their important sounding titles and their nice suit and ties. How can anyone see this as justifiable? Dylan, you said that the British was committed to their vaccine program. They were also committed to their 0.7%, so forgive our skepticism. Luke mentioned the Ethiopian Spice Girls. How can you challenge an oppressive status quo in a community who can't read or write? Through song. This is not a superfluous or a frivolous aim at all. Bob Geldof told Open Democracy that Britain has many times been through harder, tougher, and poorer times than these. But they have never retracted the hand of mercy to the helpless. We on the proposition passionately agree with what concern.org that UK has stated on its website regarding this issue. Fundamentally, no one is safe until we are all safe, and we will keep working to ensure that our support reaches those who need it the most. Help us to lobby the British government and the British people into revoking this disastrous proposal to cuts to overseas aid. Savage cuts to overseas aid proposed by the British government are unjustifiable and counterproductive. They are a false economy. The global community needs to come together at this time of crisis. The British government should not make the impoverished of the world pay the ultimate price. We beg you to propose this motion. Thank you.
Thank you, Shane. I would like to thank both teams for a wonderful debate and to thank you all for all the work you've put in. We will play a short video of this year's poetry competition winner and a presentation from our 2019 debates champions, Largie College from Clones in County Monaghan, on their trip to visit concerns programmes in Sierra Leone. I'd like to say well done to everyone for the time and effort they've put into this year's competition. Everyone here has excelled and overcome obstacles in order to be part of this wonderful occasion.
2030 by Aidamar O'Callaghan. A man-made utopia. I picture clean waters, clean air, and smiling faces. Nature is smiling right back at us. It is the year 2030. We have met our goals. Then I wake up. I see polluted waters, polluted air, and masked faces. Nature is crying for help. It is the year 2021. We must do better. A man-made utopia, a dream, a vision without action. We must be that action. It is the year 2021. We will do better.
Hi, I'm Ruth Madden. I was captain of the 2019 Largie College debating team when we won the national final, and with it, the opportunity of a lifetime. A visit to Concern Sierra Leone Mission in sub-Saharan West Africa. On the 20th of July 2019, we took off from Dublin Airport and flew to Freetown, the capital of Sierra Leone. Along with us came the winners of the 2019 Concern Fast competition, Peter, Owen and their teacher Katrina. We were also accompanied by Annika and Lauren from Concern. In considering the trip, there were many aspects. On one hand, it was inspiring to see Concern's work exemplified by projects such as their Eager project, a project whose aim through community mapping is to improve the lives of 9,000 13 to 17 year old girls by finding safe spaces for those in need of such support, and also through the implementation of basic education, encompassing not only literacy and numeracy training, but business and life skills. And then on the other hand, the injustice and prejudice when teenage pregnancy results in a girl's exclusion from school was as upsetting as it was frustrating. Our visit to Sister Mary Sweeney's St. Joseph's School for the Deaf, where the resilience and good-humoured outlook of those who met, some in the most difficult of personal circumstances, was both eye-opening and humbling. Their fortitude is something that I still contemplate today when I think things are tough for me. Being informed on the Eager Project and the St. Joseph's School for the Deaf really helped me to understand the importance of the global fight to achieve sustainable development goals, especially Goal 4, quality education, and Goal 5, gender equality. But in looking back, there were so many highlights and things that surprised me. The raw beauty of the country, the openness of the people, our meeting with Her Excellency, the Irish Ambassador, the simplicity of going to the beach or going to the Takugama Chimpanzee Sanctuary, where the chimpanzees threw stones at us. But did the trip inspire or influence me, you may ask? Yes, it did. The visit gave me an understanding of things of which I was unaware. The inequalities which still exist within our global community, and how we all as individuals have a role in endeavouring to address those. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Abigail, and I was the second speaker on the Largie College debating team for Concern in 2019. No hours of research for Concern debates or preparations for an impending trip could prepare me for the sensual and emotional contradictions I encountered as a result of our trip to Sierra Leone in July 2019. Trip of a lifetime, life-altering experience. Clichés or not, this trip left an indelible mark on me as a person. No presentation or speech could summarise the effects. Sierra Leone, a place where nothing, not even life itself, can be taken for granted. Not to mention luxuries like food, shelter and education, welcomed us with open arms. One of the eye-opening activities for me was on day 4 when we visited a primary school in a remote region. We were greeted with a tremendous welcome. Everybody in the community came out singing and dancing. The excitement, the vibrant colours and the buzz created a magical ambience. Breathtaking is an understatement. We witnessed firsthand the primary school programmes implemented by Concern. There were about 50 children of varying ages in one class being taught by an unqualified teacher who was receiving little to no salary. The classroom was rudimentary, like a wattle and dab shack from the Stone Age. The families of the children watched those being educated, and I had the opportunity to chat with a girl younger than me who was holding her 9-month-old baby girl, Zanab. I learned that when a girl has her first period, they are encouraged to leave school, and if she doesn't, she is ostracized by the community. Girls are already treated as inferior to men, but when a girl becomes a woman, she is expected to have children and work in the home. I took Zanab in my arms and I was holding back my tears as I thought of the life that lay ahead of her, in comparison to the girls back home in Ireland. Girls who often complain about their free education, their luxuries, the price of a fresh set of nails. Zanab, who is almost 3 now, may be taught to read and write, but Zanab will never be offered the same opportunities available to any of us here today. Every day when I look at this picture, I am reminded of how lucky I am, and it inspires me to do my best. One day I hope to return to Sierra Leone and meet Zanab to find out how she has fared. Has she survived? Is she receiving the basics you and I take for granted? A roof over our head, clothes on our backs, food in our tummies, and fresh clean water to drink. There is no knowing. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Aaron McMahon, and I was a member of the Larkey College debating team from 2018 to 2019. I now have the privilege of telling you about some of my personal highlights of my debating experience, and in particular, our trip to Sierra Leone in July of 2019. The experience overall, one I'll never forget. I've met so many wonderful people and got to witness many of Concern's life-improving projects in real time. Their work's absolutely phenomenal. The experience that stood out most for me was our third day in the country. This was our first day in the Tonkalili district of Sierra Leone. The night before, we'd stayed at St. Joseph's, a school for the deaf run by Irish nun Sister Mary Sweeney. She and a couple of other nuns have operated this school for over 45 years, educating and caring for the less able children of the region. Her story was nothing short of inspiring. She travelled from Donegal in the 1970s with just a handful of other nuns, and today she manages and operates the largest school for students with special needs in the country. Hearing Sister Sweeney's story made me think of how everyone can contribute towards the SDGs. Her work is helping to achieve equality of education, and while I may not be able to set up a school, I can support her work and amplify and promote the work of Concern. This is what we're all doing by participating in the debates. It might only be something small, but together we can all help make a difference. After a small tour of the school's classrooms and workshops, we headed off to visit a project at the heart of rural Sierra Leone. We were being taken to witness one of Concern's education programmes, which placed emphasis on equality and acceptance. I was expecting to arrive at the school just for a short tour, however, this is far from what happened. As we were pulling into the village entrance, we could hear the babble of festivities coming from within. Drawing closer, we discovered what the source of the noise was. The entire village had come out in force and were singing a song of welcome. For us! It was absolutely surreal. Everyone wanted to meet the group and find out more about us. When the crowd dispersed, we were able to get a glimpse into what a typical school day for a child in Sierra Leone is like. One of the practices that struck a chord with me is that students open and close each learning session with an action or gesture to indicate a safe space where anything said is not spoken about outside the group. We really enjoyed sitting in the lesson, and we even got to have a dance with some of the kids at the end. My main takeaway from this trip was that regardless of how much or how little you have, there's so much to be had in sharing with it with as many people as possible. It taught me about gratitude and how important it is to appreciate every day as it comes. It also highlighted for me just how privileged I am. The people of Sierra Leone were some of the kindest and most caring I've ever met. This trip, combined with my research and involvement with Concern debates, has opened my eyes and my heart to the wider world. The beauty of it, but also the darker side of poverty, inequality and injustice. I'm much more aware of how the obvious and the hidden human rights infringements of the world. But I'm also full of hope because I know that organisations like Concern are working and making progress in addressing this. I've always wanted to be able to help people, to improve the lives of others wherever I can. My plan is to study physiotherapy, or speech and language therapy, which will allow me to share my skills with the world. I would also love to return to Sierra Leone and share my skills with the people there, the people who welcomed us so warmly and shared their lives with us so generously. Finally, thank you to Concern for this opportunity. You've genuinely changed my life.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I now would like to invite Linda Golden, our chief adjudicator, to address the House and announce the result.
Well, thank you. Thank you to both teams for a wonderful debate. At this stage, you expect excellence. We're at the All-Ireland final, and certainly excellence was delivered all morning here by these young people, young students, and we're still in the middle of a pandemic. And here they are, having worked their way through the competition, 100 teams, we were told. And here we had the finest two teams here. And they engaged us right throughout the debate. And they didn't give the adjudicators an easy task. I'm sure you're all of you who are listening feel that. So an excellent debate on a topic that is current and very, very topical for all of us. The research, the information, the statistics, the knowledge, all of that was very impressive this morning. And that's the start of a debate, isn't it? You're given a motion and off you go and you find as much information as you can. And then secondly, you have to put the argument together. And the arguments went back and forward this morning on both sides. I think they did a great job in presenting an argument on a difficult enough motion, quite a wordy motion. And I think both teams did well in terms of defining the motion and secondly in challenging the terms of the motion. So that was the first element that we noted when we came together as adjudicators, the quality of the content and the information and the arguments. And excellence on both sides. Secondly, what also was very impressive was the commitment and the passion and the sincerity of all the speakers here this morning, putting across their arguments in their own individual way. So again, we were confronted with excellence on both sides. But then after that, we had to look beyond that. And we had to ask ourselves, well then, how are we going to select a winner? How will we distinguish between the two excellent teams and all that they have given us to judge and assess? And the first thing, obviously, which is the essence of debate, the refutation, the rebuttal, that certainly came into play. And also, it's not just refutation and rebuttal, but the precision of the refutation and the rebuttal, that you can actually take the argument and precisely undermine it. And we saw some very good examples of that here this morning. A second element that we considered, which we felt had an impact also, was the persuasive power and how you actually put your point of view across. And maybe how the pacing, the modulation of the voice, all of those have an impact when you move down the marking sheet and you look at the persuasive power of the arguments. Because we came here today to be engaged, to be persuaded. And we had to look at the various ways each team presented the arguments and how they actually used the information to persuade us. A third element, I think, would be teamwork. And difficult as it is in these circumstances, both teams found different ways of presenting, creative ways of presenting a team argument. So I think they would be the three elements, the approach to teamwork, the persuasive power of the voice and the pacing, and the refutation and maybe the precision of the refutation. They would be the three elements that we had to consider when we had to try and distinguish between both teams. And on behalf of the adjudicators, I'd like to thank both teams before I announce the decision. At this stage, you're at the peak of debating, so I don't think you need any advice at this stage. It's just to commend you. And well, we do have to announce the winner. Certainly at this stage, there is no such word as loser. And I think I just love to commend students for getting involved in the debates and for active citizenship. I think it was Toni Morrison, Nobel Prize winner for literature, who said that each generation, that young people, in a way, she found them insulting, because after each generation, they manage to do what we do so much better, and they triumph over us. And I think we can all rest assured that we have triumph here in these young people as active citizens. And that is the whole purpose of the competition. So thank you. And on behalf of the adjudicators, to announce the winning team of the Concern All-Ireland Final, the opposing team, Presentation De La Salle. And so the motion was defeated. And I won't say hard luck. Congratulations to both teams. Thank you, Claire.
Thank you, Linda. I would now like to ask for the captain of the proposition, Shane Hogan from Bailieborough, to say a few words.
Thank you, Claire. I just wanted to thank Concern for firstly hosting these debates. They've really impacted all of us here. They've changed our lives drastically. I want to congratulate the opposition team. This debate was very, very close. You were extremely good at what you did, and we wish you the best of luck in the future, and congratulations. We also want to thank our mentor, Miss Quinn, for all the hard work that she put into the debate for us. Congratulations to De La Salle, and good luck in future endeavours.
Thank you, Shane. And I'd now like to ask Stephanie Doyle, captain of the opposition Presentation De La Salle Bagenalstown, to say a few words, please. Thank you very much.
Morning, adjudicators, chairperson, timekeepers, members of the proposition, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge a number of people who have been pivotal to this year's debating competition. Firstly, I would like to sincerely thank my teammates, Staz, Katie, Dylan and Adam. Your hard work and dedication to this team over this past year has been both inspiring and a privilege to work with. I would also like to pass on my sincerest thanks to our principal, Mr. Keane, our deputy principals, Ms. Burke and Mr. Cullinan, and to all the teachers in our school. Your support and help over these past few weeks and this year is something that I can say hand on heart that we will never forget. We'd also like to thank Sean, the man behind the magic in our school. We really appreciate your support and all of your hard work in getting the posters ready for the final. To Mr. Power, your devotion and dedication to this team has been both incredibly important to us. You've been the rock of the team since day one, and we will be forever grateful for your hard work. We would also like to thank Geraldine and the whole of Concern for organising the debates. It has given us an opportunity to learn, grow and broaden our understanding of the world. To all the adjudicators, both today and previously, you've played an instrumental role in our development as speakers and provided encouragement that has helped our confidence to grow and flourish. We are forever grateful for your contribution to the programme and your help and guidance. And finally, just as every story has two sides, so too does a debate. And I would like to take this opportunity to thank the team of Bailieborough Community School. Shane, you and your team were certainly a force here today. We feel privileged and honoured to have debated against such a ferocious team, and we wish you all the best in the future.
Thank you, Stephanie. Well, I would like to say a massive congratulations to both teams for a really, really brilliant final debate. On behalf of Concern Worldwide, I'd like to thank the adjudicators, timekeeper and the schools for their help with this debate. Congratulations again to Presentation De La Salle, our Concern Debate 2021 Cup champions, and commiserations to Bailieborough Community School for a wonderful debate. We hope we'll see both schools back in the debates again next year, and of course to thank our adjudicators here and at home, as well as all of our wonderful debates teachers and of course the students themselves. Just before we go, Concern would like to thank Irish Aid for their support to Concern's work in the Global South, as well as Concern's global citizenship education work here in Ireland. Thank you for watching, and on behalf of Concern, we look forward to seeing you again here next year. Thank you.